We will talk about polls today, as we have shown in the Laplace transform presentation. The transformation into the S domain offers certain advantages, and in terms of solving the differential equations, the mathematical operations turned out to be very simple algebraic fraction manipulations instead of the complicated way to solve the differential equations. And today we want to take a look at the certain relationship between the fraction in the S domain and its corresponding math relation in the time domain, and how they can be related to each other through this very simple concept called poles. So what are poles? Let's say if we take a look at a particular fraction in the S domain, such as this example that we have here. The pole is simply the denominator of this particular fraction. When we set it equal to 0, the result of S minus 3, this is what we call the pole of this particular relation. Here's a table that shows how the poles relate to the original time function and its corresponding transformation in the S domain. Here are several transformations and their poles for common functions used in the system dynamic course, especially this particular course. And I want to go over them very, very briefly. For unit step function, the transform is 1 over s. We have a single pole of s equal to 0. When you have a polynomial, or actually a nomial to degree n, it corresponds to a fraction with s to the n plus 1 in the denominator, and n plus 1 of poles at s equal to 0. As you notice, the number of poles is 1 extra than the degree of the nomial. For the exponential function, it translates to a very, very simple fraction, 1 over s plus a. And we have a pole of a real number, which could be positive or negative. I'm going to skip a line and take a look at sine and cosine. Both represents a quadratic relation in the denominator for the S domain. And you have imaginary poles for both sine and cosine. If we look at combinations of these poles in this particular example, where you have a nomial multiplied by an exponential function, the end result is the fraction represents both the characteristic of the nomial, which is raised to the degree plus 1 of the nomial, and this s plus a nature of the exponential function, and results in multiple poles at the real plane. Same thing. If we go ahead and put the exponential function and sinusoidal functions together, we're going to result in a complex pole that has the characteristic of the exponential function, which is real number, in combination with imaginary number poles, which are consistent with sinusoidal functions. If we plot the poles onto a map, we call it pole map, in the S domain corresponding to the complex axes, this is what the pole map looks like. On the x-axis, you have the real axis, and on the y-axis, you have the imaginary axis. The poles in the middles are representative, actually, the poles in the origin are representatives of nomials. The degree of the nomial is always 1 less than the total number of poles. The imaginary axis, poles on the imaginary axis, represents functions, that are oscillatory, such as sine and cosine. Poles on the real axis, such as here and here, represents exponential function. If we have a negative real pole, the function, exponential function, is decaying. If you have a positive real pole, your function will be exponentially growing. And based on the pole map and the combinations of the locations of the poles, we can then very, very quickly find the behavior of the function in time domain as it corresponds to the S domain. Let's take a look at this particular example. Assuming we have successfully solved the differential equation x, the solution to this differential equation, such that we got the x in the S domain, and now we're trying to find the behavior of the solution in the time domain. And I'm not interested in the entire inverse Laplace transform because I'm not interested in solving for the constants at this particular point. At this point, I can then deploy the method of poles that we just talked about using the table that we had, trying to figure out what kind of behavior we have in the time domain. So let's go ahead and take a look at the poles. Again, poles, we start by setting the denominator equal to 0. So you're going to have a pole at s equal to negative 1 and two poles at s equal to plus or minus 2i. If you remember, or if you have the table on the different slide or on the side, you will realize that this negative real pole will correspond to an exponential decaying function, a exponential minus t, and plus minus 2y is going to correspond to oscillatory function, cosine 2t plus sine 2t. And since we can use the superposition principle and say that any solution of the differential equation are additive, we can then add them together. And you now have a very, very quick general solution to this differential equation, or quick solution as a result of this inverse transform of x of t. And we can quickly say that the behavior of x of s in the time domain will be exponentially decaying and oscillatory. Let's take a look at one more complicated example. This is again the result of solving a differential equation. We now have the result of the differential equation in the S domain. Approaching the same way, looking at the poles by setting the denominator equal to 0. Of course, sometimes they may not come out in this very, very clean form. You have to do some algebraic manipulation to get them in this clean form. We have three groups of poles. The first group has a double pole at s equal to 0. The second group has a triple pole at s equal to minus 1. And this last group has a complex pole at s equal to negative 4 plus or minus 2i. So let's take a look at them a group at a time. The double pole, remember, anything that you have duplication of the poles, they represent something of a polynomial. And your polynomial is always 1 degree less than the total number of poles. In this case, we have a total number of 2 poles. Therefore, you're going to have a polynomial that is degree 1. Second case, we have two characteristics. One is you have a negative real number, which indicates an exponential behavior of your poles. Again, you can use the table or the pole map to come up with this answer. A second behavior is triple poles. So remember, triple poles, you corresponds to a polynomial degree 2. Therefore, we're going to have ct squared dt plus e. And we multiply these two together. The last one, two behaviors again. A negative real pole, actually a negative real component and oscillatory component, or the imaginary component. Combined effect, minus 4t, f cosine 2t plus g sine 2t. So let's look at the characteristic of this result. Ramp, which is unstable if t approaches infinity. Here is an exponential decaying function plus a quadratic equation, or multiplied by a quadratic equation. The exponential decaying function is going to go faster, so when t goes to infinity, this drops zero. Again, we're going a little bit ahead, but I just want to kind of give you some preview of what's to come and what's the use of these equations without knowing the constants. Here, we're going to have an exponentially decaying function multiplied by some kind of sinusoidal input. So if we were to plot them, this looks like a straight line. This looks like maybe something that is going to go up slightly and then start gradually decaying. In this one, you're going to have something that decays but that oscillates. So your solution will be the combination of the three graphs. And of course, if we were only interested in stability and the behavior of the solution in terms of, is it stable, is it not stable, is it vibrating or not vibrating, you don't necessarily have to solve for the constants. Based on this pole analysis, we know the answer already.